During the last Arduino Basics 102 video, I showed you how you can utilize control structures to create more complex sketches that can light up your LEDs in a variety of different ways. But now you want to attach external components to your Arduino, like an inductive proximity sensor, an OLED display, an RF communication IC, or for example a real-time clock. Something like the proximity sensor is pretty straightforward to connect, since it only has one output pin that either connects to the supply voltage or not. But if we take a closer look at the other components, we can see that they feature quite a few pins that all need to connect to the Arduino. As a practical example, let's try to control the OLED display. In order to know how to connect it, and most importantly talk to it, we firstly have to take a look at its datasheet that presents us its compatible communication protocols, as well as a very long command table. For a beginner, or a lazy person like me, this can be quite scary. That is why it is usually much easier to Google for compatible Arduino library, download it and include it in the library folder of your Arduino software. The library itself usually consists of pre-written code lines and a couple of example sketches. In those, it is often explained how to connect and initialize the component, and how to use the different simplified commands to utilize all the functions. And just like that, we can include the library in our own sketch, and thus tremendously decrease the work necessary to get a component to work correctly. Now let's move on to the weird lines of code you sometimes see in Arduino sketches. And to start off simple, let's write a short piece of code that turns the digital pin 11 on and then off again. After uploading it, we can connect the pin to the oscilloscope to observe that it turns on and off with a frequency of 73 kHz. And for many applications, this is good enough. But what if I told you that by utilizing two weird lines of code instead of the digital write function, we can increase the frequency up to 1 MHz? Now the reason for the slow digital write function can be found by opening the wiring digital file, which presents us all the commands that take place while executing the function, which obviously slows it down. But to understand the port manipulation that I used, we have to take a closer look at the datasheet of the Atmega 328P. There we can find the I/O ports section that tells us that each port pin consists of three register bits: DDXN, PortXN and PinXN. What I used was the port register bits, which pulls the output pin high if the bit was a 1 and pulls the pin low if the bit was a 0. In total, there exist three of those port registers: port B, which represents digital pin 8 to 13, port C, which is the analog input 0 to 5, and port D, which is the digital pin 0 to 7. By using the Arduino pin mapping diagram, it is also easy to recognize which digital pin correspond with which port and bits. Now we can easily set almost all the register bits of port B to 1. And thus turn on the digital pins 8 to 13. And by converting all those bits back to a 0, we can turn them all off absolutely simultaneously, which is, as you can see, a lot quicker than using the digital write function. And just in case you're wondering what the B in front of the bit stands for, it means bytes, which is a variable type that consists of 8 bits. Okay, moving on. Let's say you want to use pin 10 as a PWM output to create an 80% duty cycle. As you can see, it works without a problem, but the achieved frequency of only 490 Hz is too low to utilize the signal in, for example, a boost converter. The solution is to have a closer look at the three timers slash counters of the Atmega 328P. Because counter 1 creates a PWM signal on the output pin OC1A/B, which according to the Arduino pin mapping is pin 9 and 10. It also tells us that the timer can be clocked internally via a prescaler, which is defined through the bit 0-2-2 of the TCC R1-2B register. To identify the default value of those bits, we can use the CUE monitor to output the value of the register, which gives us an 11. As a complete byte though, this would equal 6 zeros with 2 ones at the end. That means CS10 and CS11 were 1, which according to the clock select table equates a prescaler of 64. So let's try to select a prescaler of 1 to increase the frequency. The utilized command here might look complicated at first, but it is quite easy to understand once you know how bitmap works. For this line, we only need the ampersand as the AND and the vertical line as the OR. First off, the register with its supposed unknown values performs an AND function with 5 ones and 3 zeros. The ones actually don't change the content of the original register, since we don't want to mess with them. But the 3 zeros at the end force the result to become zeros as well. Next, this new result performs an OR operation with a bunch of zeros and a 1 at the end. Since the logical OR does not change the original values if a 0 is involved, pretty much everything except the far right bit stays the same. After these math operations, only the CS10 bit is a 1, and we didn't mess with the rest of the register. Which means after uploading the codes, everything still works fine, and we successfully increase the frequency up to 31 kHz. Now let's move on to the last, most complicated example. Apparently, we want to modify the register ADC SRA, which can be found as always in the datasheet. As some of you might already have thought, the bit 0-2-2 are once again used to set a prescaler, this time of the ADC. Now the byte PS16 basically uses the left shift bitmap operator to move the 1 to the position of the ADPS2 bits, which needs to be a 1 in order to set the prescaler to 16. The other prescaler bytes also set this bit to 1, but additionally set a second or third bit to 1 as well to reach the targeted prescaler. Next, we got this line, which is basically an abbreviation, and the weekly line is used to flip all the bits of the PS128 around and thus ultimately not mess with the bits 3 to 7, but write a 0 to all the prescaler bits. And finally, the last line once again leaves the not prescaler bits alone, but writes the 1 of the PS16 bytes to bit 0, which thus increases the sampling rate of the ADC from the original 112 microseconds to 15 microseconds. And with that being said, you're now ready to try out more advanced Arduino projects and hopefully learn even more along the way. I hope you liked this video. If so, don't forget to like, share and subscribe. That would be awesome. Stay creative and I will see you next time.